So here with Councillor David Gibson, who is the finance spokesman for the Green Party Council on Brighton and Hove City Council. Welcome back, David. And we're going to start off by talking about the budget, because it's a fast approaching. Maybe just start off by talking a bit about the budget process, and then we can talk about the challenges.
Well, the big date this week is the comprehensive spending review, when we'll get a better idea from government about what resources are likely to be available, and we really need 3 years certainty, because year to year is very difficult to plan, and it's not efficient. So we get that, we put that together with the estimates from the different departments about how much they're going to need to save and how they can save money, and then there's a draft that's then discussed internally with councillors from the other parties, some of the proposed savings, then a draft budget in December, and then finally it and that's sort of open for consultation with the unions, and finally in February there's budget council where the decisions are made and parties will come with their amendments. But fundamentally, and to lead on to your second point, is we're facing a really difficult round this year. The estimates change. It's dangerous to use numbers, but at the moment we're looking, could be £18 million short, which is an awful lot to make up. Yeah. Now this will change from month to month, and hopefully it'll get a bit better, but it's an incredible challenge, and that comes on top of over 100 million cuts through austerity in previous years. So we're not talking about, sort of trimming, for the first time around. The local authorities have had year on year, and we thought it was ending, but it's still going on, really.
Yeah, and we don't know where we're going to be, do we, in February? I mean, obviously at the moment we don't have another lockdown. The plan B's not been activated, so it's going to be an uncertain few months, isn't it, I would say?
It certainly is. There's, last year we had an even bigger gap, and the government came good in terms of covering a lot of that. So fair play there. But there's no contingency money for lockdown now, and there's the pressure on adult social care costs, which is a national issue. Every year that really drives and that pressure to keep up with that drives council spending, and unfortunately makes it very, very difficult to set a balanced budget.
So how can you raise money then? Is there any ways that you can raise extra funds in the future? Is there any way that can change the picture now and February?
Really good question. So the government will in the past have always had a cap, and then you have to have a referendum, which you might not win. Particularly people are going to vote for paying much higher council taxes. Last year we were allowed to do an extra couple of percent for adult social care. We might be able to again this year, though it was supposed to be over 2 years. So we're hopeful that cap might be a bit higher. So that's the most straightforward thing is council tax. And we are seeking to protect the lowest income households with council tax reductions schemes. The other way we can raise money is through fees and charges. And people will know that, in the past, parking costs have gone up across the city, and that's one of the few levers we've got.
Social care, so that's a big spend, isn't it, for the council? The biggest spend is, people think it's like, refuse collection and bins, etc. It's actually social care. It's a big challenge, isn't it?
It is. It's the big pressure. That's the one that we've got to find a way of meeting that demand, and probably, the government has recognised it. They've come up with the national insurance increases, mostly for the health service to start off with, but eventually some of it will filter through to social care, but a lot of it will filter through to protecting people who would otherwise have had to pay for it out of their wealth, basically. So I'm not clear how much that will benefit in at our level, and I'm certainly don't expect it to in the next couple of years in any significant way.
Yeah, it's difficult, is it? So I mean, what else do you think could be done with the social care aspect to it? I mean, a lot of it's not in your hands, is it? It's a national government led decision, really, isn't it, about how that's funded, the bigger picture at least.
Yeah, and the pressures, the pressures of an ageing population are inevitably, that's not the only sort of social care, but that's going to carry on. I think as a council, we've got to try and learn from other councils, you know, what's worked well in other places, and try and replicate that. But fundamentally, we need government money, you know, to cover it, and we need it now. We don't need it possibly, you know, sort of in 3 years' time or something like that.
Yeah, rented sector in Brighton, it's costs are astronomical, can't they, for a lot of people, and they're really struggling at the moment. So I know you've tried to bring in rent licensing for all landlords. I know you've got the HMO licensing, and that's been an issue of Acorn as well, hasn't it? Came up in full council meeting. Just to give us an update on the rental sector. And where we're at on
that. We're in kind of dialogue with Acorn or negotiations, and they make demands, and we are completely committed to trying to achieve licensing, whether it's licensing across the whole of the city or a smaller area, but there needs to be the evidence. At the moment, council officers don't believe they've got the evidence. We're committed to trying to find the evidence and go through all the stages, because it's in our joint manifesto in Housing and Homelessness with Labour. We want to do it, and we've found some resources to do a bit of a review of what's happening in other councils. So, because to find out whether or not in the last 2 years whether licensing schemes are getting approved, if they are getting approved, what for, and whether it's a citywide one or just a small area. So that is one important piece of research, but we still need to find the evidence, and we also need to demonstrate to the government, it's quite a high bar, we need to demonstrate to the government that our existing enforcement is insufficient and hasn't helped, improve conditions. And we are currently investing £195,000 on enhanced enforcement. That will come on stream this month.
Yeah.
No, next month, because it's November.
Yeah.
And we need to give that a bit of a try. And we're hopeful that will alleviate things, whether or not, you know, we get licensing. But we're saying to Acorn, we're pushing ahead. We're setting a date that we think is the earliest we could probably agree to do it in committee.
Yeah, is it because no one's really done it elsewhere, have they, with rent controls? I know we've had it in years gone by, but not in recent times.
Yeah.
There hasn't been a national rent control scheme.
So licensing, it would be about the conditions of the property and its social behaviour.
Yeah, yeah.
Rent controls is under, as you say, it's a national control. Yeah. There used to be what were called like fair rent tenancies that were sort of much more affordable. In other European countries, you've got rent controls of different varieties.
Yeah.
And as a living rent campaigner, I've argued for rent controls here, but we're quite a long way off, unfortunately. And we can't do that locally.
Yeah, and I have to say, I did work in Brussels when I worked for the European Union. There was a rent control in your contract. I mean, I never understood the formula of some crazy little formula that they used that was in the contract, but it seemed to work there. It was pretty cheap. Okay, what about homelessness then, to finish up on housing in the first half? Because that is a big issue as well, isn't it, in the city? I've spoken to your colleague, Cyril Hugh-Jones, about this. It's a big challenge, isn't it, over the winter period?
Yes, and I think one of the worries is now they're lifting the eviction ban in private renters, that we'll be potentially seeing more homelessness. And we've been very successful in terms of the Everyone In, and the number of verified rough sleepers in Brighton and Hove has reduced by the largest amount outside of London, according to the last count. And we've got to try and sustain that, which means we need to find more accommodation, and we need to be able to move people on, because it's costing the council quite a lot with all the budget pressures. And our great achievement at the moment as a council is we're expanding additional truly affordable or affordable council homes. We did 144 in the last year, which is the most we've ever done as a council, and we need to keep pushing on with the supply of affordable housing, because that's the other side of the homelessness, is something that people can afford. And it's not just the council, we need housing associations to do it as well, but at the moment we are sort of setting a bit of an example with that.
Yeah, exactly. What about the kind of the system in place if, you know, temperature drops below a certain level, that kind of hole? Yeah. winter crisis regime you have in place. When's that going to kick off? Is that in place?
Yeah, that's already in place, right, and that's called SWEP, Severe Weather Emergency Protocol.
That's what I was looking
But because we're doing everyone in, people should be housed anyway, no matter what, whether the temperature's 5 degrees, and it's making that work. We've got St Mungo's, doing the outreach work, and then we've got these no-second night-out facilities. We need to move people into there and then move them on quickly, because if we don't, then they get full, and that's when you struggle more. But there will always be some people, if we're thinking about the rough sleeper end of homelessness, there will be some people that, for a variety of reasons, won't move in, not even with the emergency cold weather stuff.
Yeah.
So there'll always be some people that just say, leave us alone.
Yeah, exactly. All right, we're going to leave it there, David, for the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be back with Councillor David Gibson to talk a lot more about what's going on in Brighton and Hove. Join us then. So back here with Councillor David Gibson, Green Party finance spokesman on Brighton Hove City Council. And we're going to go over to social housing. We spoke about rented housing in the first half. Just give us an update on what's going on in regards to social housing in the city, David.
Well, we're working flat out to maximise the number of additional council houses that we achieve. And I think I mentioned earlier, we've achieved 144 last year, which is the best ever. And we've got the joint venture with the Hyde Group, which is now controversial to some extent in the Coldean site and in Port Slade, but that now there's raising from the foundations. And what's really exciting about that is that the rents that we're going to be able to charge are lower than were originally envisaged, what I'd call a living rent, thanks to government grant, so that Hyde are passing on. So we'll be actually getting, I think it's about 174, 176 additional council houses from that. They'll probably not be till after May 2023. So,
right.
But that's a big chunk. And we're still committed to our 800 additional. It'll probably take us 5 years with the pandemic rather than the four that we'd originally planned, but we're going flat out and we're getting somewhere. So that's a positive. It's good news.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of new developments going up in the city, isn't there? So you'll be getting some social housing as part of the agreement with the developers. I would have thought, I'm thinking Sackville Trading Estate, I'm thinking Lewis Road with the University of Brighton development around there.
Yeah, well, that does happen. It doesn't usually come to the council, though. We're looking into buying some what's called sometimes off plan, or you can buy some of the allocation.
Yeah.
So that is, and we're up for that, because anything we can do. And I certainly know a little bit about the Lewis Road, and I think it's Optivo
as an
association are buying quite a decent number there.
Homex, I think.
And they're getting grant towards it. So that's That's positive, yes.
Yeah.
As the developments start to, pick up, well, the Lewis Road has been going for a while, but then potentially there could be a bit more coming on stream.
Brilliant. So that's that. And climate change, then, for the rest of the half. Got COP26 coming up, haven't we? China, India, Russia probably not joining, or their heads of state not coming along. I mean, is it already looking like a damp squib, or what's your expectation for COP26?
It's last chance saloon,
it
so
is.
It can't be a damp squib. And people like myself are hoping to go to Glasgow and raise our voices. And it really is. There's been too much prevarication, too many pledges that haven't been met, and it's the future for the next generation. And in the West, we have the greatest responsibility because we pump most of that carbon into the atmosphere in the first place.
Yeah. What about locally? You've got the 2030 net carbon zero target. How are we getting along with that?
I wish I could be as optimistic as I was about the social housing. Last year, we found over 20 million investment, which is brilliant. But I was talking to you earlier about the pressures in the budget. And it's a big priority to continue and sustain that. And we'll be working to try and, you know, sustain those levels of investment. But without government support as well, it's going to be such a huge challenge. It can't just be the council. We'll do what we can, and we will strain every sinew to try and get resources in this very tight budget round. But we need support from government. We need businesses to play their part. We need residents. So we've all got to quote another politician, you know, I'd call myself a politician, that's terrible. We're all in it together, and we've all got to be part of the solution. And so it will require huge mobilisation, and we've still got, you know, we'd go all out for it, but it's going to be a battle.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? And I mean, because we're only a small part of the picture, aren't we, the UK? I mean, the big emitters are China and Russia, USA, of course. So, I mean, what do you think is going to happen, you know, over the next 2 years? Because it seems that the Joe Biden administration is a lot more climate-friendly than, you know, President Trump ever was.
So yeah, and
we could have a movement from the US.
That is really hopeful because, as you say, I think they're the second biggest emitter, or they were last time. I looked.
And I think China's number one.
China is number one, but we are buying the goods from China. And so they're actually doing all that emitting, but actually if we weren't consuming the goods that they were producing, so in a way we're saying, oh, well, look how well we're doing, but actually because we're pulling in, you know, the goods that have cost carbon in China, then that's not so good, really. And really, fundamentally, I think the big issue that people have to face up to is that we've got to consume less. We cannot go on consuming so much of the world's resources to the extent that we have done. And what's really needed is, sorry, I'm on a bit of a roll
now,
Mark.
Yeah, that's all right.
Is that if you want to get better outcomes for people, you need to have less inequalities. All the research shows that you get better health, happiness, less crime, suicide, if the gap between the rich and the poor is lowered. And that's what we've got to do. We don't want to produce more and more and more. Growth doesn't do it. Doesn't do it for the population as a whole. What does do it is narrowing the gap. That's what we've got to do. We've got to say, all right, we're not going to produce more and more and more and more and go for endless economic growth. We're going to share out what we have done, both in this country and on a global scale, and then we get better outcomes and it's better for the climate. End of my speech.
Yeah. What I mean, reusing, materials is, you know, reusing clothes and kind of that whole kind of circular economy is probably the way forward as well, isn't it? And
absolutely.
Brighton's fairly good at that, isn't it?
Yeah. There's certainly a really strong strand of what we're trying to do. Yeah. There's a circular economy working group, and that is incredibly important. And yes, people say recycling, but actually it's reusing as far as possible.
Yeah.
That's the gold standard. And just thinking, well, I'm not going to throw away my fashion for the summer and buy another one because it's cheap, you know, because actually there's carbon gone into the next one, and we've got to, we've got to make things last longer, build things to last, repair more.
Yeah.
And we'll still be happy as long as we're not really divided.
Yeah. Just time for a ward update. So Hanover and Elmgrove, I know I've spoken to Councillor Elaine Hills about the low traffic neighbourhood. How's that progressing over there in Hanover and Elmgrove?
It's into the consultation now.
Yeah.
So, and we've also got covered cycle racks. That's being consulted around the city, but I know there's a lot of enthusiasm in that ward. A lot of need because little terraced houses, very hard to get your bikes into the back, and there's not much space at the back. So that's really, really positive. So it's moving on.
Yeah. Okay. What else is happening in Hanover? What comes up in a post bag at the moment? And what issues? I know. Blake, is it the? I know you've had a regeneration of the parks in your area as well, haven't you? Across the city as well.
Yeah. There has been investment in parks. Yeah. And not directly benefiting Hanover and Elmgrove. One of my big projects at the moment is to support the social supermarket, which is making the food, what was an emergency pandemic food bank, into something that's sustainable, because there's going to be a lot of, you know, we've got rising costs, fuel costs, furlough ending. People are going to be really squeezed. So this is quality, affordable, at really discounted prices food for people that really need it. So it's a fantastic project. Very positive about that. And of course, we do get the odd email about bins and rubbish.
Yeah, exactly. What about going forward then? Had a full council meeting there, didn't we? So what the next full council meeting? Do you know that as what's going to be coming up on the agenda? What's the kind of the period between now and Christmas looking like?
Well, I'm not sure about a full count. There's one due in December, but I don't know what will happen with the one that got postponed. So whether that will be reconvened, in which case to deal with the items that didn't get heard. The big issue for me will be the budget stuff that's coming in December. And we've got a housing one in November. We're trying to move on. Cyril probably mentioned it about the plans to retrofit and make carbon efficient all the council housing.
And that's a big thing, isn't it? Insulation has come up, going back to climate change, before we finish up.
We've seen
Insulate Britain. So, I mean, that insulating homes, it is something that Councillor Hugh Jones is actually working on in Brighton. Because, I mean, there is a point to be had there, isn't it, about insulating your homes. It is a big carbon emitter, isn't it? The fact that we don't actually have warm homes is really bad for the environment. And it is one of the big emitters.
Absolutely.
If you wouldn't know about it, wouldn't necessarily. It's not obvious, is it?
No, people think about exhaust fumes and other stuff. Yeah. And you're absolutely right. It's a huge area, and it's one that requires investment. It will save people money on their fuel bills, and it will be good for the environment. So it's a win-win-win, but it requires investment. And that's the thing with all these climate change things. It does require investment, but in the long run, it saves money for everyone because of the consequences of climate change and not doing anything are more expensive.
Yeah. Brilliant. We'll leave it there. Councillor David Gibson, thanks for coming today. All the best. Cheers. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Mark.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.